The 99th Rejection Slip by Lucille Baldwin van Slyck. This is recorded to celebrate the 9th anniversary of LibriVox. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. When Priscilla Colton came back to Brockton after her senior commencement, she carried with her a little bundle of papers which she called the Sorrows. Neither her rather stern father nor her somewhat stern Aunt Jane had the remotest idea of her hidden grief, because Priscilla was a plucky soul, and she had tucked the Sorrows down into the very bottom of the battered toy-chest in the rather droll study she had made for herself in her dismantled nursery. Every summer for 4 years she had hidden the steadily growing bundle in the same resting-place, and bravely tried to pretend she was forgetting it. But this particular summer was rather different. She had grown old enough to know that pretending could not help. No budget of bills nor bundle of love-letters could have possibly had as many tears shed over them by Priscilla as she had actually shed over that fat sheath of papers. But they were about the only things she did cry about, and being a methodical young person, she had a sort of melancholy pleasure in keeping every one of the hateful messages that had caused her so many outbursts of disgust and anger. In bitter moments she would spread them all before her on the lid of the battered toy-chest, and shake her small fist at them, especially at the last 20 or so. They had initials at the bottom. Jerky, crabbed initials. The defiant twist of those initials infuriated her. All in all, with the score or more of initialed ones and the others, Priscilla Colton had exactly 97 rejection slips from the same magazine office. Back in the dark ages, when she had begun to collect them, she had quietly determined that 99 would be her limit. Just what Priscilla would do on the horrid moment of the arrival of the 99th, she had never definitely decided. It had seemed such an amazingly large margin when she determined upon it, that she had not realized she would ever face such a decision. Moreover, the arrival of the 97th, during the delicious whirl of commencement, had not received its proper outburst of dismay. In the earlier days, the proper outburst of dismay had been a rather tempestuous proceeding. Of course, it varied a little as Priscilla grew older, but it always retained many of its whimsical distinctions. It invariably began with a violent hatred for editors. Individually and as a class, she would abhor them desperately for 20 minutes, or possibly half an hour, until she would suddenly reflect with grim joy that as yet she had never seen an editor. This thought always brought her to the somewhat pleasanter stage of reviewing what she would say to an editor when she did meet one. Here again the details varied as Priscilla grew older, but at all ages she was quite positive that she would never consent to meet one until she had become famous. On the eventful day when she was properly famous, and the one with the crabbed initials stood outside her door begging the butler gradually disappeared as Priscilla grew older, but he was so comforting a feature of the outburst of dismay that Priscilla retained him much longer than she afterward admitted. Pleading with the butler, who wore a distinguished-looking livery of maroon with silver buttons that was delightfully reminiscent of the first tailored suit Priscilla had ever possessed, and who presided at the imaginary door with great dignity and cotton gloves, and stern instructions to say to everybody, "Miss Colton regrets that she can allow no one to disturb her while she is engaged on her newest book." When the crabbed initialed editor, who was, of course, homely and bald and bespectacled and meek, should be ushered into her presence by her secretary, who should be just as formidable as the butler, only a trifle more shabby, Priscilla would arise with great dignity, and gently putting before the much humiliated editor the little bundle of rejection slips, would say, I have consented to see you so that you may know that you have never really mattered. Even in those days when you were causing these sorrows, you never really mattered. But had I in those far-off days been possessed of a less grim purpose, these might have driven me to desperate lengths. This point in the outburst reached, Priscilla usually grew much more calm. But the next stage was almost as exciting. It consisted of a review of the miserable thing she hated next to editors. It was writing. Priscilla loathed the miserable rub of a pencil against paper. She detested the scratch of the pen. She simply could not endure the clatter of a typewriter. She did not know which were the worst sight, a clean bit of paper waiting to be inscribed, or a crumpled-up one lying in the bottom of the wastebasket. She cordially despised the neat row of ing-lit books which she had laboriously ploughed through at college, and she positively glared at the appallingly long row of various helps for the young writer that she kept hidden in the battered toy-chest. The bugaboo of writing hung over her like an ogre, a blonde lady ogre. For the fundamental rock on which these two overpowering hatreds of Priscilla's otherwise happy life rested was a condition Priscilla badly lumped as next door. From the dormer windows of the study that had once been a nursery, Priscilla could look across a terrace, a tennis court, and a hedge through a celebrity's vine-clad windows, and watch a celebrity stenographer taking dictation from the only celebrity in Brockton. There were days when this sight was almost more than Priscilla could endure. To be sure, she had most ingenious modes of revenge. In the early days, one of the most impish had been to tumble madly downstairs in her most fetching tennis togs and summon a horde of admiring youths who would enter into noisy contest on the tennis courts beneath the celebrity's windows, until those windows were banged shut by worried-looking maids. But this and similar forms of revenge were as nothing compared with the master stroke Priscilla had begun to plan on the day when she had heard the words which created a necessity for revenge. She was only a bit over 16 when, crouched in the comfortable shade of the dividing hedge, she had heard a visitor of the celebrity remark upon the prettiness of the unseen eavesdropper. "That Colton's daughter is even prettier than her mother was at her age," suggested the flattering voice. But even while the listener was still flushing with delicious egotism, the calm voice of the celebrity began the fateful speech. "And sillier and more stupid," she had replied easily. "I used to think, when we were all girls together, that Angela Sheldon was a synonym for fool, the most brainless human I ever knew. But Angela's daughter is a shade worse." "Then at least you'll never have a rival scribbler next door," the visitor had laughed. "Scribbler!" retorted the celebrity. "I doubt if the absurd infant can write a letter decently. Thad Colton's ideas about education are so utterly absurd that the girl knows next to nothing. If it weren't for Jane, they wouldn't even be sending her to college. The little fool has absolutely no purpose in life except giggling and playing tennis, both of which annoy me excessively." When the 16-year-old Priscilla had sobbed out her heart over the taunts at the pretty little mother she could scarcely remember, and had cried a bit more at the blow to her own silly pride, she had vehemently planned a fitting revenge. She would learn to write, and she would have all the stories she wrote printed in the very same magazine in which most of the celebrities' stories appeared. Every one of these stories should be signed with Angela Sheldon's name. But most crushing of all, some day she would actually write a book, and the first copy should have both her mother's and her own name upon the title page, and it should be sent in silent contempt to the celebrity. All of which would have remained a deliciously absurd and childish plan, had not the desire grown so constantly stronger that its achievement seemed an absolute necessity. At 20, the persistent Priscilla was beginning to realize that she had set herself a serious task. Yet it had never occurred to her busy father, nor her prim Aunt Jane, that there was anything more definite under her brown tangle of curls than determining each day's fun. The arrival of the 98th rejection slip was a tragic moment. The very initials looked more aggressive than usual, and underneath the printed formula in the same hateful scrawl was added, "A bit too subtle fun for our readers. Why tease us?" As it had really seemed to Priscilla that the rather bulky longhand manuscript she had called Mists of Dawn was so much like the last published story of the celebrity, except that she privately believed it much better, it was distinctly humiliating to have a shabby, bespectacled, bald old editor insinuate that it was meant to be humorous. She held the detested little grey slip at arm's length and stared at the familiar printed formula until it blurred through her tears. To be told for the 98th time that they thanked her for the contribution, but regretted that it was not exactly suited to the present needs of the editors, was rather more than her overwrought feelings could endure. "If ever in my life I can find out any possible thing that is suited to the needs of an editor," murmured Priscilla despairingly, I'll wish on every star I see that he never gets it, and that he thinks he is just dying for it. And while he is dying for it," she ended vindictively, "I hope I'll be there to tell him that my rejection of his wishes does not necessarily imply any lack of merit on his part, but that it simply means he isn't suited to the needs of any human being." The reactionary outburst of dismay would have probably lasted longer than usual, had not Priscilla, staring out across the terrace with eyes still reddened by perfectly legitimate tears, observed the celebrity's anemic stenographer explaining to the celebrity's gardener that he must not cut the celebrity's lawn, because the celebrity had an exceedingly busy day ahead and must have absolute quiet. Priscilla's lips curved themselves into the same whimsically malicious line she used to twist them in the riotous old days when she had been wont to annoy the celebrity by gathering the neighbourhood youths to the tennis courts. A few moments later she whirled into Aunt Jane's sitting-room with her eyes dancing with naughty fun.
"I've telephoned every living soul I know in this town and a lot from the next," she announced breathlessly. "We're going to have the thrillingest party today that we ever had in all our lives. And it's going to be on the lawn, and it's going to be a continuous performance, because I just happened to find all the lanterns we used to hang up for my birthdays, and they need using. They look so lonesome."
"There isn't time to get ready for it."
"Run along and count the spoons," replied Priscilla. "I told everybody to bring everybody they ever knew."
She flung herself in a childish heap at her aunt's knees.
"Jansy, darling," she entreated, her brown eyes heavy with threatening tears, "I can't endure it if I don't have this party. I'm such a lonely orphan, with a Spartan fox of despair gnawing at my innards. I'm that miserable I'll just die if I don't have a party. And you know that a party is much less work than a stylish funeral."
Within an hour, the Colton lawns were in a state of delicious chaos. Motors chugged noisily in the drive. Eager youths dumped heaps of foolish paraphernalia on the tennis courts. Amateur carpenters whistled and banged and sawed, and the girls fluttered about them with squeals of delight at the unexpected fun. Indoors, Aunt Jane and the maid were dashing about madly, improvising a dozen times too much supper.
"Anything we haven't," suggested Priscilla artfully, as she remembered the noisy gong on the celebrity's kitchen gate. "We can borrow next door." late afternoon found a gypsyish young person in a comic opera sort of costume welcoming all of the guests who were not already shrieking preliminary instructions at each other on the lawn. There were tents and booths and stands, a bewildered organ grinder who ground out his tuneless tunes with maddening stupidity, half a dozen youths with an improvised sideshow for which they ballyhooed as professionally as though their very livelihood depended upon their success as noisemakers. The gypsyish young person tried to smile demurely as she glanced across the riot of colour and confusion.
"You're the corkingest person on earth," declared Benzie Wilmar as he presented a car full of guests. "I couldn't have kept this wild bunch amused 5 minutes in this burg if you hadn't had this party inspiration. You're saving me food and gasoline, you are. You are an angel person."
"I'm not," she flashed back with a sudden whimsy of remorse. "I'm just having this party to be mean. I have the most malicious disposition in the world. And I don't care at all who comes to my party. Anybody can come," she ended wickedly. "Anybody who can help make a lot of noise."
The last youth to be presented leaned abruptly across the hedge at this broadcast invitation and hailed a solemn-faced young man who had just started away from the celebrity's door with a lawyer's fat briefcase in his firm hands.
"Will you let good kids in half fare?"
he cried over his shoulder to the shining-eyed hostess.
"There's a pious cousin of mine passing on his way to... Come here in, Ned, or hither."
The solemn-faced young man rudely consulted his watch before he deigned to turn through the gateway. He viewed the frolicking young persons about him with a vaguely tolerant smile. In the glorious excitement of her party, the gypsyish hostess greeted her last guest rather carelessly. She scarcely seemed to see him as she took the briefcase from his hands.
"Greetings to anybody tall enough to string the top lanterns without a derrick," she chattered. "The children in this town are all so small. The stepladder is over by the edge of the court, where the last applicant threw it."
The solemn-faced young man stared at her most disapprovingly. "If I may have that case back," he suggested firmly. "Some rather important papers."
"We'll tuck them in Dad's safe,"
she responded, as she handed them to a passing maid with decisive instructions.
"Be sure you get the pinkest lanterns on top. Benzie Wilmar will want the green ones there, but that would be horrid when you lighted them."
"I really do not believe," began the solemn-faced young man,
and suddenly discovered that he wasn't talking to anyone at all save his own frolicsome cousin, who was decorating him with wreaths Hawaiian fashion and tucking a ball of cord into his hands.
"Look here," said that astute young person. "I never met our present landlady till just now, Ned, but she looks awfully good for the thing that's always ailed you. And you needn't worry about trains. Benzie will take you back to town when he takes our bunch down."
The afternoon faded into twilight. The twilight lost itself in the soft gleam of the lanterns. The impromptu revellers laughed and danced and sang with joyous abandon, and among them wandered a solemn-faced young man who was gradually getting less solemn-faced, but who ran obediently at the beck and call of the gay little hostess, who flashed among her guests with her dark curls bobbing under her gaudy cap, and her dark eyes shining with mischief.
"Stepladder, please,"
she called him with such a soft inflection in her caressing voice that he was not in the least conscious of her outrageous impertinence. He stood beside her at the top of the terrace, watching her bid her guests good night. It was not very late, but the little laughing group squabbled good-naturedly about suburban trains or recklessly begged rides of those who had motors.
"I'm sorry to trouble you," said the solemn-faced young man very firmly, "but I'm the chap that Wilmer's friend invited. They're taking me to town in his car. You gave your maid a leather case of mine this afternoon, and I must have it before I thank you for my unexpected holiday."
"Miss Jane closed the safe at 5 o'clock," announced the maid.
"That's all right," answered the hostess easily. "It's nearly 11, and Dad will be in on 11:10. Benzie," she called across the terrace, "run down for my dad, will you? I was stupid and locked up your friend's papers, and I'll be arrested if you don't get Dad to unlock them."
The solemn-faced young man found himself waiting this time in a huge porch chair. The last of the revellers drifted away. The little figure in the gypsy dress flitted here and there, pointing to the maids. Aunt Jane, flushed and weary, paced about, picking up her beloved spoons and forks. One by one the lanterns blinked themselves out, and the solemn-faced young man, sitting quite forgotten in the shadows, began to lose his temper. He was just lifting himself for one last attempt to assert himself, when the gypsyish young person crept wearily up the steps, flung herself into the broad swing, and, pulling her gaudy cap from her curls, began to cry, very softly, but very hopelessly.
"I beg your pardon," he stammered miserably.
"Good gracious!"
snapped the gypsy crossly.
"Why can't you boys go home? You might know any girl wants to cry after such a hateful party."
"I thought it a very nice party," he said stiffly. "I would have gone some time ago if you had procured my case for me." He snapped out his last remark a bit viciously. He was utterly disgusted with her persistent forgetfulness. Priscilla's voice grew very small.
"I'm that sorry," she murmured contritely. "I truly didn't mean to be so hateful, so annoying. That is, to anybody except next door."
To her amazement, the solemn-faced young man leaned forward, stared at her through the gloom, and began to laugh. A big, quiet, chuckling laugh.
"Say," he confided, "I've been wanting to annoy next door for years and years, only I didn't dare."
"Do you know her?" gasped Priscilla.
"Only in a business way," he explained rather elaborately.
"Well," answered Priscilla, "maybe she isn't so bad in a business way, but I perfectly hate her," she ended in a spasm of honesty. "And I had this party, this whole hateful party, deliberately just to worry her. And now I'll have to go and be remorseful, and I loathe being remorseful."
There was something really very friendly about the solemn-faced young man's laughter.
"I don't see why you think that is funny,"
continued Priscilla a bit sharply.
"I'm not trying to be amusing. If somebody discovered you hadn't any brains about 5 years before you discovered it yourself, you wouldn't feel very... well, I'll bet you'd feel rather rubbly about it once in a while."
"Who thought they discovered you hadn't any brains?" asked the solemn-faced young man boldly.
"Next door!" snapped Priscilla.
"Then it doesn't follow," he rejoined easily, "that you haven't. She's all brains, got too many. Probably you've got more than the normal amount."
"I haven't enough to write with," faltered Priscilla.
He moved his chair toward the swing. He reached out a comfortable hand and grasped hers firmly. "Shake," he admonished tersely. "I've waited a million years to meet you. All the women I ever knew and ever will know write. Even my mother," he added with such mock pathos that the girl began to laugh, a tearful half-laugh that pulled some of the bitterness from her voice. A motor whirred softly into the drive. His obstreperous cousin and her rather stern father alighted. Presently, perfectly proper introductions and explanations ensued, and the solemn-faced young man stood on the veranda, his recovered case in his hands, and began once more to say good night to his chance hostess. There was something in the gleam of his eyes that made her usually unobservant father watch the departing guest a bit curiously.
"You're a lawyer, too?" he asked.
Benzy Wilmar and the obstreperous cousin shouted.
"That chap a lawyer?"
teased the cousin.
"Nothing so innocent as that, Mr. Colton. He's a villain, he is. One of those villains called editors."
Priscilla did not even say good night. She fled. Pink with the laughter of self-mockery, she put her head into her pillows and laughed until she wept, and wept until she laughed again, and kept on laughing until her laughs trailed into smiles and the smiles into slumber. And in her sleep, the imaginary butler and the make-believe secretary mocked her. Aunt Jane roused her in the morning, holding a little note stiffly before her.
"That chap Ben Wilmar took home left this," she said.
Priscilla sat up drowsily, opened her brown eyes, and stared at the envelope. There was something very familiar about the writing. She turned to the bottom of the included page and saw that it was signed with jerky, crabbed initials. Her last night's mirth dissolved in anger. She spent the morning writing a score of impertinent epistles to him. She ended with the most impertinent of all, in which she informed him that her decision not to see him on Sunday, as he suggested, did not necessarily imply any lack of merit on his part, but simply meant that he was not exactly suited to her present needs. For, after all, she could not forget that there were 98 rejection slips, and a score of them signed with jerky, crabbed initials. But she spent the afternoon locked in the little study that had used to be a nursery. Early in the evening, Aunt Jane knocked once more.
"I'm very busy," murmured Priscilla chokily. "I can't see anybody."
Aunt Jane, still somewhat stern from the party, did not attempt to argue, but shoved something under the doorsill.
"He insisted that I give it to you," she grumbled. "He said he would wait till you came downstairs."
It was a grey printed slip, and it informed her in the familiar prim lettering that the manuscript she had so kindly submitted was not exactly suited to the needs of the editor. But the editor would like, added the crabbed writing, to discuss his needs with you. After all, she had never really determined what she would do on the arrival of the 99th. She merely smiled dreamily as she found herself mechanically tucking it into the bundle with the others. She shut the lid of the battered toy chest thoughtfully. Then suddenly she opened it tempestuously, caught the whole bundle in her slender hands, and kissed it. She went downstairs very demurely, and behind her stalked an imaginary butler coughing behind his imaginary white glove, and an imaginary secretary who sighed piteously. They had served her faithfully through many crises, and they regretted leaving her, for with astonishing perspicacity they realized that she would never need them again. So they walked by the smiling young man who was waiting in the shadows of the rose vines, and behind them strutted a young woman who smiled tremulously. She was going to have at least 99 revenges before she submitted a rather important contribution to the editor. She kept her voice quite even, but her brown eyes danced with laughter.
"I have consented to see you," she began soberly, "so that you may know that you never really mattered."
He took both her young hands in his. "Possibly," he agreed very pleasantly. "But you see, I do now. Now that I realize," he grinned wickedly, "the present needs of the editor." End of the 99th Rejection Slip by Lucille Baldwin Van Slyke. Recording by Ruth Golding.